Once I was asked by a millennial student to give a modern day equivalence for anencephalic fetus. Being a diehard Mac fan, my prompt answer was, anencephalic fetus is like a MacBook Pro without a CPU and a hard disk.
My name is Dr. Ajit Virkud. I am a professor of obstetrics and gynecology from Mumbai, India. My subspecialty is urogynecology and pelvic reconstructive surgery. Obstetrics and gynecology is my profession, but teaching is my passion. My area of core competence is teaching basics of obstetrics and gynecology.
Hello, citizens of the interweb. Today, I'm going to talk to you about anencephaly, which is a severe congenital malformation of the fetus that is incompatible with extrauterine life. I will discuss its pathophysiology, diagnosis, prevention, and treatment, and one more thing which I will reveal at the end. So stick on till the conclusion of the video. The reason why this severe malformation is very important is because it can be totally prevented. The incidence of anencephaly during pregnancy is 1 in 1,000, but the average birth prevalence of anencephaly is approximately 1.2 per 10,000 births, because many of these cases diagnosed end up in spontaneous miscarriage, fetal death, or pregnancy termination when early diagnosis is made. Some of the geographical hotspots where the incidence is as high as 1 in 100 are Guatemala, Mexico, Northern China, and Ireland. Another interesting feature is that this congenital malformation is 10 times more common in females than in males. In order to understand the pathophysiology of anencephaly, one must refresh a little bit about CNS embryology. The central nervous system appears as a plate of thickened ectoderm called the neural plate at the beginning of the third week of embryonic life. The lateral edges of the neural plate become elevated to form the neural folds and fuse to form the neural tube. The fusion begins in the cervical region and proceeds in both the cranial and caudal directions. One of the critical moments in development of the CNS is the closure of the anterior and posterior ends of the neural tube. The cranial neuropore closes on the 25th day and caudal neuropore closes on the 27th day post-fertilization. Neural tube defects result from failure of the neural tube closure between 25th and 27th days after conception. If anterior neuropore does not close, anencephaly develops. And if posterior neuropore does not close, spina bifida develops. Absence of telencephalon, which embryologically develops into the cerebral cortex, leads to anencephaly. Absence of the brain and calvaria may be partial or complete. Remember, folic acid and myoinositol are required for this. Maternal diabetes is also a high-risk factor. As far as the etiology goes, anencephaly, like other forms of neural tube defects, generally follows a multifactorial pattern of transmission with interaction of multiple genes as well as environmental factors, although neither of them are well identified. In some cases, anencephaly may be caused by a chromosomal abnormality, or it may be part of a more complex process involving a single gene defect. Talking about the phenotypical features, this anomaly is characterized by congenital absence of forebrain, skull, and scalp. Some rudimentary forebrain tissue may exist, and a functioning brainstem is usually present. The fetus has a characteristic frog head appearance because the cranial vault, cerebellum, and portions of the cerebellum are absent. The cranial portion is covered by a membrane or occasionally skin. Facial structures are generally present and appear relatively normal but have a triangular shape. When additional malformations such as spina bifida are present, the likelihood of cytogenetic abnormalities is increased, requiring further cytogenetic studies. Other congenital malformations frequently accompany anencephaly. In one study, cleft lip and or palate or omphalocele occurred in 12.7% cases. Craniofacial and ocular abnormalities often occur. Cardiac, pulmonary, renal and skeletal malformations may be associated. Aganglionosis of the intestine is a frequent finding. The recurrence risk of neural tube defects such as spina bifida or anencephaly is approximately 2-4% when there is one affected sibling. When two affected siblings are present, the risk is approximately 10%. The risk of recurrence appears to be higher in countries such as Ireland, where the prevalence of neural tube defects is high. This familial clustering is due to genetic factors, environmental influences, or a combination of the two. Although pelvic ultrasonography is the gold standard method for diagnosis of this malformation in modern obstetrics, it does not mean that in our generation that studied in the pre-ultrasound era, one could not make a diagnosis of the condition. I will tell you how. We had one clinical sign and one simple investigation, that is X-ray. On pervaginal examination in labor, palpation of the soft presenting part, that is the head without the calvarium, through the dilated cervix causes the fetus to show sudden jerky spring-like movement that can be perceived per abdomen. This positive spring sign is suggestive of anencephaly. This is plain X-ray of the abdomen and pelvis, AP view, showing anencephaly fetus in cephalic presentation with face as the presenting part. Please note, vertex is absent. Anencephaly can be diagnosed by transvaginal ultrasonography as early as 10 weeks. In the first trimester, absent calvarium, reduced crown lump length, absent or exposed neural tissue with lobular appearance, and absence of normal head contour geometry with the orbits demarcating the upper border of the face in coronal view are suggestive of the diagnosis. Another characteristic appearance of this malformation in first trimester is acrania. Acrania is absence of the calvarium with protrusion of the brain tissue. The amorphous brain tissue resembles a shower cap. This is a diagnostic finding in acrania. Of course, anencephaly is the later step of acrania. In the second trimester scan, the characteristic features of anencephaly which can be seen are absent calvarium, prominent orbits, and the face is typically triangular. This is another zoomed picture showing lenses as white circles in the prominent hypoechoic orbits. Before I talk about the laboratory diagnosis of anencephaly, some basics. Neural tube defects that are covered by skin are called closed defects, while those that are not covered by skin are called open neural tube defects, which are anencephaly and spina bifida. Remember, only open neural tube defects are detected by screening tests. The concentration of alpha fetoprotein in fetal blood is 100,000 times greater than it is in maternal blood. Some of the fetal alpha fetoprotein normally enters the maternal blood, and so the alpha fetoprotein concentration in maternal blood will begin to increase. A fetus with an open neural tube defect will transfer more AFP into maternal blood than an unaffected fetus, and so an unusually high AFP concentration in maternal blood can indicate that the fetus has open neural tube defect. Because AFP concentrations normally increase during pregnancy by about 15% each week, a statistic called multiple of the median MOM is used to normalize the test result. The figure illustrates the distribution of AFP multiples of median results in women with unaffected fetuses, those with spina bifida, and fetuses with anencephaly. Maternal serum alpha-fetoprotein screening during the second trimester of pregnancy, that is between 15 to 22 weeks, is an effective screening tool for identification of the vast majority of cases of anencephaly in women with or without a positive family history or other risk factors for neural tube defects. Different cutoffs are used. A cutoff of 2.0 will detect about 85% of open neural tube defects, and a cutoff of 2.5 will detect about 75%. Having said this, it is important to keep in mind that most abnormal neural tube defect screening tests are false positives. There are several reasons why AFP might be elevated in the absence of an open neural tube defect, such as an abnormality in the fetal kidneys, a ventral wall defect, that is an opening in the abdomen, the death of a fetus, a twin gestation, hyros fetalis, sacrococcygeal teratoma, or most commonly underestimated gestational age. Because this is a screening test and not a diagnostic test, women with abnormal result require additional testing to confirm if the fetus has a neural tube defect, such as amniocentesis. Another parameter used for laboratory diagnosis is acetylcholinesterase. High, that is 10.2 to 19.5 units per liter of acetylcholinesterase levels in amniotic fluid is a confirmatory evidence of presence of an open neural tube defect like anencephaly. Remember, laboratory investigations like maternal serum alpha-fetoprotein and acetylcholinesterase are not routinely used in clinical practice for a diagnosis because it can be made easily with non-invasive ultrasonography. As I have said in the beginning of my e-lecture, this severe congenital malformation can be totally prevented using periconceptional folic acid. Folic acid supplementation and/or a folate-enriched diet prior to and during future pregnancies are recommended. Different associations have different recommendations as shown in this table. I am not going to elaborate these in detail, but in summary, we give a single 4 mg or a 5 mg tablet per day from 3 months prior to conception and for the first 3 months of pregnancy. I will discuss the management in two parts. Part 1, when early antenatal diagnosis is made, and part 2, management during labor and delivery. After a definitive diagnosis has been made, the most important part of the management is counseling of the couple that focuses on providing a supportive environment in which the family can come to terms with the diagnosis and make preparations for their loss. Patient may be referred to a counselor who is skilled in delivering grave information and is knowledgeable about recurrent risk prevention, screening, and diagnostic testing options for future pregnancies. If prenatal diagnosis of anencephaly has been made, management varies according to the gestational age at diagnosis. At pre-viable gestational ages, pregnancy termination should be advised. Late diagnosis at gestational age that do not permit medical termination of pregnancy as per the MTP Act of India creates a dilemma in management. A special court order may be required to get permission for termination of pregnancy. Some patients or couples may refuse termination and opt to continue pregnancy. In such cases, the important thing to remember is that those anencephalic fetuses who have associated polyhydramnios will go into preterm labor, whereas in the absence of polyhydramnios, pregnancy is more likely to become postdated. This is because of the absence of pituitary gland. Labor may need to be induced in these cases. talking about management in labor, these fetuses deliver as cephalic presentation with face as the presenting part or as breech presentation. If delivery occurs in cephalic presentation, the small head may slip through an incompletely dilated cervix and result in what I call pseudo shoulder dystocia. After delivery, most anencephalic infants die within days or weeks without life supporting interventions. A woman who has just delivered a stillborn anencephalic fetus will require emotional support and possibly grief counseling. In most cases, direct personal contact with the baby may help the parents to actualize the medical information they have been given and may help in the process of grief resolution. And now I will talk about the one more aspect of anencephaly which I mentioned in the beginning of my e-lecture, and that is organ harvesting. Anencephalic infant organs have been used for transplantation in the past, but there is considerable difference of opinion and ethical debate over whether they should or should not be used for such purposes. Families who request the opportunity to donate organs from their infants with anencephaly should have information and educational material provided that explains why this practice is not supported. The option of tissue and stem cell donation should be discussed using the ethical principles and medical practices applied to other donors. FIGO Committee for the Ethical Aspects of Human Reproduction and Women's Health has recently stated that the purpose of organ donation constitutes an ethical ground for a woman to choose to maintain an anencephalic pregnancy. Counseling of women and couples regarding organ donation should be undertaken by persons with no conflict of interest. When an infant is born with signs of life but has no forebrain, that is anencephaly, and hence has no prospect of survival, with parental permission, the child may be placed on a ventilator for the purpose of organ donation following natural death. Any local legal definition of death is binding, but it may have to be reviewed in the light of scientific development of criteria concerning brain death in neonates. I would like to end this extensive emotional e-lecture with this poem by a woman who has lost her child due to severe congenital malformation such as anencephaly. It goes like this: and though our arms are empty, our hearts know what to do. Every beating of my heart says, I remember you.
If you want to study more about this topic or any other topic in obstetrics and gynecology, please read the following books written by me: Practical Obstetrics and Gynecology, Modern Obstetrics, Modern Gynecology, Clinical Cases in Obstetrics, Questions and Answers, Clinical Cases in Gynecology, Questions and Answers, and Pelvic Reconstructive Surgery, a monogram on pelvic organ prolapse. For purchase inquiries, contact me at email given below or ping me at the WhatsApp number mentioned below. Also, please subscribe to my new YouTube channel called Modern OBGYN that deals with basics of obstetrics and gynecology, and press the bell icon to get regular notifications about new uploaded videos. Thank you.